1,600.
Good evening, colleagues. Welcome to the meeting of the council. Please be seated.
Thank you.
I am required to inform you that this meeting is being recorded. If any member of the public or press would like more information about this, or if they intend to record proceedings themselves, please contact Strategy and Democracy Services, who will be more than happy to advise. Any member who wishes to speak on any of the agenda items should use the microphones available. The first item of business is declarations of interest. No declarations have been received. Does anyone now wish to verbally make any declarations before we move on to the next business? The next item of business is the minutes of the meeting of the council on the 14th of June and the extraordinary meeting of the council of the 5th of July 2018. Are they accepted as a true record?
Agreed.
The next business is Mayor's Communications. It is my great pleasure to announce that at a national prestigious awards event held on the 25th of June 2018, South Tyneside Homes Repairs and Maintenance Team won the Housing Heroes Award for Development and Maintenance Team of the Year. I would like to invite Councillor Ed Martin to say a few words about this award. Councillor Ed Martin.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. The South Tyneside Homes Repairs and Maintenance Team in 2017-18 managed to reduce the number of repairs from 102,000 repairs to just over 83,000 repairs, whilst maintaining quality of service, providing cost-effective service, and increasing customer satisfaction at all levels. The award recognises the delivery of high-quality and efficient services against the background of challenging financial times. These achievements have been recognised nationally by the Chartered Institute of Housing, who awarded the Team of the Year Award. Mr. Mayor, this is a good achievement, a grand achievement for our housing company, South Tyneside Homes, and I would like Gary Cursor from South Tyneside Homes to hand over the award.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. I'm delighted to receive this award on behalf of the council and South Tyneside Homes. Thank you very much. The next item of business is to consider proposed changes to outside body memberships, which I have already agreed to take as an urgent item. I will ask Councillor McCabe to move the changes. Councillor McCabe.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to move that Councillor Dean replace Councillor Kay Maxwell on the South Tyneside Citizens Advice Bureau Management Committee, and Councillor Keegan to be appointed as the third representative for the Tynemere Fire and Rescue Authority.
Is that seconded?
Seconded.
Are there any questions on, or does any member wish to speak on the proposals? Is the motion agreed?
Agreed.
I do apologise. Councillor Milburn.
Yes, there is a total of this one.
Stand up for the mayor, please.
We talk about funding here and about the election. What I would say was that the She reported that the government funding has been cut by South Townside by almost 50% since 2010. Budgets have decreased and demands have increased. South Townside Council, for whatever reason, have rejected the city's Development Devolution Act of 2016. Just this week, the Prime Minister announced a new council, North Side Alliance.
This isn't on the agenda. This isn't on the agenda, Mr. Gavin.
It's the next item, Jeff. Next item.
The next business is to consider the report of the Agriculture Director, Economic Regeneration, which provides a regeneration update. I will ask Councillor Allen to formally move the report. Councillor Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This report is for information only and provides Council with an update on our regeneration activities. With regards to the regeneration of South Shields Town Centre, our partnership with Muse Developments has continued. The Word has been a major success in its first 18 months of being open and has received international recognition, as well as attracting over 650,000 visitors and winning numerous awards, including National RBA Awards and RICS. The marketplace refurbishment was completed in 2016, and we are now working with Groundwork to deliver an expanded market offer to provide a more diverse visitor offer and attract footfall into the town centre. Property acquisitions have been necessary to assemble development sites for both phases 2 and 3. I can report that by March 2018, all properties required for the regeneration have been vested across to the council. Consequential regeneration benefits arising from the acquisition strategy have seen a new post office opening in King Street, as well as a new state-of-the-art Royal Mail sorting office at Lady, which builds upon our earlier regeneration activities with London Energy Green and new homes built in Trinity South. Discussions are going on with the DWP to bring forward a new Job Centre Plus facility at Mile End Road. Work is also in hand to convert the former Riddick shop on Fowler Street. And phase 2 of 365 regeneration will see a new transport interchange built on the site of the former Royal Mail post office. Working closely with Muse and Nexus, we have appointed Bomer and Kirkland as main contractor, and the scheme is currently under construction and completion is expected in summer 2019. Phase 2 will also see significant public realm improvements at Keppel Street, as well as highway improvements at Coronation Street, Crossgate and Garden Lane. Phase 3 of the regeneration will see new retail and leisure opportunities brought forward by Muse in the town centre. New modern retail units, new cinema and restaurants, all of which will broaden our visitor offer. It is anticipated that the planning application will be ready for submission in 2019. Hebron Town Centre continues to attract investment following the opening of Hebron Central in 2015. Hebron Central has seen increased gym membership contribute towards greater well-being in the community. The owners of the shopping centre have invested in the buildings and have rebranded the centre, and officers are working with the owners to attract new businesses into the town. Aldi are on site bringing forward their new supermarket, which is expected to be completed and open before the end of 2018. It is also being refined for the demolition of the former Hebron Library, which will enhance the town centre public realm. Jarrow Town Centre continues to trade well in the Viking Centre as low void levels are maintained to a high standard by the owners. Investment in new facilities at Jarrow Community Centre will be completed by December 2018 and will see an enhanced gym offer, new accessible entrance design and improved range community facilities. Turning to the foreshore, we continue to build on our earlier successes highlighted in these reports. Successful coastal community bids have seen further investment in the public realm, which improved connectivity between the pier and amusements, which builds on the success of Haven Point. Summer festivals have attracted crowds of over 25,000 at our Bent Park events, again creating space. investment in the fairground as well as on the seafood tank. Following a successful stage one bid, we have now received £2.4 million grant from the Heritage Lottery Fund for the restoration of North Marine Park, where work is intended to start on site later this year. The next item is a new one, is Holborn Riverside and Middle Docks continues to be a key regeneration priority for the council. And the council is seeking to create 200,000 square feet of Grade A office accommodation and associated commercial uses on land which has already received enterprise zone status together with residential and other uses for a comprehensive mixed use development on this unique waterfront site. In December 2017, the council acquired a major private land interest, giving it control over the majority of the site, and we are now refining delivery options for consideration by members of the future day. Finally, turning to IAMP, having secured £42 million in regional growth funding, the joint scheme with Sunderland City Council, which will be transformational in terms of its impact on the regional economy, will create 6,000 jobs on 150 hectares of land, development which will be focused on advanced manufacturing and the supply chain to the automotive industry. Henry Booth Limited has been appointed as the development partner to deliver the scheme in partnership with the public sector, and start on site was achieved in June 2018. Colleagues are requested, Mr. Mayor, to note the report.
Is that seconded?
Seconded.
Are there any questions on it, or does any member wish to speak to the report?
Now, Jeff.
Is the motion agreed?
Agreed.
The next business is to consider a report for the Operations Director on Cooperative Council Progress Recognition. I will ask Councillor Cunningham to formally move the report. Councillor Cunningham.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This report is to inform colleagues of the progress we have made since becoming a Cooperative Council in April 2017 and signing up to the Cooperative Council Innovation Network. Being a Cooperative Council is all about a specialty thought of working in a way which helps get the maximum from all of the resources available to the community. So, how are we embedding this cooperative ethos and principles into our day-to-day business? Well, we give a real voice to our residents through our community area forums. Our procurement process has increased our local spend to 50% and embeds social value principles, which I think is really, really important. We work in alliance with our health partners. We have a nationally recognised approach to corporate parenting. We have over 2,000 community groups operating within South Southside. We have 1,300 residents at least who undertake some kind of volunteering work in South Tyneside. We have 70 organisations registered to provide volunteering opportunities. And we have over 20 friends of groups who operate across the borough, bringing added value to our parks and open spaces. Through the positive response of our communities and their actions in coming forward to take over the running of community buildings, we also ensured the financial viability and sustainability of over 19 valued facilities. These include leisure centres, youth activity centres, community associations and libraries. The centres, which are now run by social enterprises, are going from strength to strength, with many examples of improvements to the facilities, the range of activities on offer, and increased participation levels. One of our centres is establishing a national reputation as a centre for excellence. In April 2018, the Council was invited to apply for the first ever Cooperative Council of the Year Award. And following our submission, we were one of a small number of councils shortlisted for this prestigious award. The Council did not win this award, which was won by Cardiff Council, but we're not bitter. However, to become one of the few shortlisted councillors is a testimony to the progress we have made in a relatively short space of time. And being shortlisted also gave me the opportunity to speak at the National Conference. There might have been more where South Tyneside was when we went, but we certainly knew about us when we left in the choice.
They did.
So, colleagues, watch this space. Our aspiration is to be the Cooperative Council of the Year 2019. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah.
Is that seconded?
Seconded.
Are there any members? Are there any questions on order? Does any member wish to speak to the report? Is the motion agreed?
Agreed.
The next business is to consider a report of the Corporate Director, Children, Adults and Health on South Tyneside Healthy Schools Programme. I will ask Councillor Mark Walsh to formally move the report. Councillor Mark Walsh.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm moving this on report on behalf of Councillor Dixon, come here today. South Tyneside Council Public Health Team deliver the Healthy Schools Programme. The programme contributes to the South Tyneside Partnership 20-year strategy by supporting better education and skills and healthier people in communities. Healthy Schools contributes directly to the outcomes prioritised in the Joint Health and Wellbeing Strategy and the Children and Families Plan Best Start in Life. Not only are our schools outstanding educational institutions, they are settings that shape the lives of young people. Schools create social norms for young people, which shapes their attitude, beliefs and behaviours. All of our children attend school which is engaged in the programme in some way. Evidence tells us that the Healthy Schools Award improves attainment, behaviour and results as well as health. The Healthy Schools Award was originally a national programme. As a result of the coalition government's decision, local authorities were asked to localise their offer at schools. South Tyneside Council designed their programme based on local need. Schools apply to become a healthy school by completing a set of criteria which inform by best practice in four areas: healthy eating, physical activity, personal health and social education, and emotional health and well-being. Schools are marked on a point system and their application is verified by a quality assurance group of professionals in each of the key public health specialist areas to ensure the standard is high. At the time of writing, 60 out of 63 schools are in date with their health school accreditations. A list of schools who achieved their award this year can be found in the report. 100% of schools in South Tyneside are currently engaged in the programme in some way. It is estimated that the programme has a reach of over 20,000 children and young people, but this could be greater impact on the wider family and rural community. This report celebrates this reach, as well as sharing good practice projects like Feeding Mind, Healthy Breakfast Clubs and Mental Health Champions. This is a really good news report which comes off the back of the annual Public Health Awards in June, where the latest successful schools have celebrated their achievements and organisations receiving the Better Health at Work Awards and the Change for Life quality mark. Mr Mayor, finish the report.
Is that seconded?
Seconded.
Are there any questions on, or does any member wish to speak to the report? Councillor Mullen.
Thank you, Mr Chairman. If the Healthy Schools Programme is ever disgraced, why have the Council not sought any information or provided any information as to whether these schools, whether the programmes are actually working? It's 100% commitment by all the schools. With the bit of obesity on the rise and the Healthy Schools Programme taking place for 9 years, has taken place for 9 years, I'd like to put it on the agenda for a September meeting, some evidence and some progress as to actually how it's scored and how our schools score against the national average. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, obviously it's not my portfolio, so I don't really have that deal as a chance at that council member. But obviously as pupils move through the various cohorts in school, their attainments are assessed along the way. But we'll ask the lead member to come up with a full answer.
Mr. Mayor.
Councillor McKeon.
As Chair of the People's Committee, these statistics are readily available and have been made available from two meetings ago. So are they in public domain?
Does any other member wish to speak on the report? Is the motion agreed?
Agreed.
The next business is to consider a report of the Head of Legal Services on members' allowances 2018-19 and 19-20. I will ask Councillor Ed Martin to formally move the report. Councillor Ed Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, by law, every local authority has to agree a scheme of members' allowances which includes how much councillors should receive for undertaking their duties. This report proposes a revision to the scheme of allowances for members for 2018-19 and the scheme of allowances for 2019-20. When setting allowances, the council must have regard to the recommendations of an independent members' allowances panel. The council cannot change the allowances scheme without first consulting the panel. Members will recall that at the Borough Council meeting in April, an unchanged allowance scheme was adopted for 2018-19, pending the outcome of the staff pay negotiations. Members will also recall that the independent panel agreed to review allowances once the pay negotiations were concluded. The negotiations resulted in a two-year pay award for staff, with an increase of 2% for 2018-19, backdated to the 1st of April 2018, and a further 2% increase from the 1st of April 2019. The panel agreed the same formula should be applied to members' allowances, with the exception of the mileage allowance, which is based on HMRC rates. The revised scheme also takes account of the splitting of the former Education and Safeguarding panel into two new panels, Education and Skills and Safeguarding Children and Adults. The appendix to the report sets out the independent panel's recommendations, the revised allowance schemes for 2018-19 to be backdated to the 1st of April 2018, and also recommended allowance scheme for 2019-20. I move the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Is that seconded?
Seconded.
Are there any questions on, or does any member wish to speak to the report? Councillor McCabe.
I understand that one of the members of the independent panel is retiring. Could the new member can you advise on what the process is for his replacement, please?
Mr. Mayor, to my knowledge, the gentleman hasn't retired yet, but when he does, then we will adopt a scheme to appoint a new member of the independent panel. It will be a public appointment.
Councillor Martin?
Yeah, can the lead member confirm that we are legally obliged to place, to have in place a scheme of allowances for councillors by law, and that it is an independent panel, and it is up to that independent panel to review and recommend the appropriate level of allowances?
Mr. Mayor, I refer the councillor to my opening statement that by law, every local authority has to agree to a scheme of members' allowances, and that the council cannot set allowances unless there is a recommendation of the independent members' allowance panel.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Councillor Martin Walsh.
Yes, can I ask the colleague member to confirm that these increases are in line with those awarded to the staff following national pay negotiations?
Mr. Mayor, I refer the councillor to the report and paragraphs 2 to 3, which outlines that the allowances are in line with the increases to the staff pay awards.
Councillor Hull.
Mr. Mayor, colleagues, I really didn't think this would be the subject of my first speech in this chamber, but after reading the report and looking at the other council allowance schemes around the region, I really felt I needed to comment. Our basic allowance is the lowest in town area, and our special responsibility allowances aren't the highest. The £35,000 total proposed for our leader pales in comparison to the £46,000 paid to the leader of Sunderland Council. But it is significantly higher than the £26,000 the leader of the biggest city in our region gets. Our cabinet members receive 25% less than their counterparts in Gateshead, but but that's still 30% more than those in North Tyneside. We have more committee chairs and vice chairs who receive special responsibility allowances than any other town in the year currently, and the amount they receive is usually more. Most concerning is the extra 5,000 paid members on the Police and Crime Panel, which compared to the 439 paid by Newcastle, the only other authority who paid for this, could be seen as a little excessive. Now, I'm not saying we don't work hard, but can we honestly say that we all spend at least 12 hours a week on council business every week of the year, and that our council members spend 30 hours a week on council business? Because, based on the average wage in South Tyneside, that's how many hours you'd have to earn for the allowance.
Point of order. There, Mr. Mayor. 33.3, subsection 1 of the Code of Conduct for Councillors. No councillor will stand up in this chamber and accuse anybody of improper motives. And that's what's happening here. And I move that under a point of order. The councillor is no longer heard.
The next business is to receive questions under procedure rule 8. No questions have been received under this rule. The next business is to receive motions under procedure rule 12. No motions have been received under this rule. That concludes the business for today's meeting. Thank you for your attendance.